good player. So let's give it to Manoj.
Yep. Yeah, we'll wait for 30 seconds to get people settled in. Then we'll talk. Hello everyone, my name is Manoj and I work for Host Analytics. A very good afternoon and welcome to the Selenium conference day one. Yeah, so today's topic, smart test failure analysis with Elasticsearch. I think a lot of you guys are spending a lot of time in analyzing the failures on a day-to-day basis, and this is the last thing you want to spend time on, right? Before starting the talk, I want everybody to stand up once. Thank you. So we have scribble pads or notepads. Just drop it on your chairs. And I want you guys to clap twice if you agree with what I say. Okay? You want to spend time wisely on writing new tests rather than spending time on failures. You agree? Two claps. Okay? Now, you are spending less than 1 hour per day on failure analysis. Really? Less than 1 hour? You're spending more than 2 hours per day? Oh. Cool, thanks. Then this session is for you. And we have only 20 minutes. Our session is time box. So let's make best use of these 20 minutes. And let's go back home and fix some problems, OK? So Host Analytics, who we are, what we do, we partner with finance to help them and the organization to achieve peak performance. We also provide single cloud-based EPM platform. It has everything you need, planning, consolidation, modeling, reporting, analytics, et cetera. And if you can see the Host Analytics evolution, we are the first cloud EPM solution and first cloud consolidation or close management solution provider and so on. And so many of you know Gartner's Magic Quadrant. Okay. So we are the only company apart from Oracle to be listed as leaders in both financial corporate performance as well as strategic corporate performance management quadrants. And this is the test automation evolution at Host Analytics. We started somewhere around 2009 on test automation. Initially, we actually were using Silk Test. And then we moved on to Wattin, which was then used as a unit testing tool. We enhanced that to utilize for functional testing. Then in 2014, we started with Selenium. And now we are a full-grown framework we have to automate and execute the test cases. And this is the automation evolution from 2016 to 18 in terms of number of test cases we execute on a daily basis. Today, we execute or run close to 12,000 test cases on a daily basis, and that takes a hell lot of hardware and time and energy. So we have an ecosystem for this execution. So this is the test execution ecosystem we do. We use TeamCity for continuous integration and continuous delivery, and Jenkins for distributed execution management. And you can see all the automation client agents, which are used as a automation clients for executing the test cases. And for at the end of every test suite execution, we write the test results to a database. And we have built our custom dashboard, which will display the reports and results on a daily basis. Okay, this dashboard will be used as a health check on a day-to-day basis. What is the functionality that is broken, and how much of the functionality is fully working condition? Okay. As you see, this is the sample execution results dashboard. We call it the daily execution trends. We display for the last 1 week. And you can see out of like the typical failure rate would be wavering around 4 to 7%. If you consider that stats, the around 4 to 5% of 9,000 would be somewhere around 350 to 400 test cases per day. So imagine a QA team working on or spending time on debugging all these 400 test cases on a day-to-day basis will take a lot of time. It's not the effort where management or even the team want to spend their time on, right? So what we did was we classified the failures. What are the typical failure types we encounter on a day-to-day basis? The first one is functional issues. Basically, any functionality is broken, our automation test case will be failed. Second one is test script issue, flaky tests. We are not using the right identifiers to automate. This is a case of UI automation. Third one is test infrastructure issue. It could be an issue with the environment or a Jenkins issue or issue with the client or something or the other. And the last one is test script catch up with UI and functionality. So how many of you will face this issue, like some functionalities change, some element locators are changed, but the test cases are not updated with the functional changes. So this is the last part of the issue what we face. Typical failures are classified into the percentages, whatever that is shown here. About 50% are test script issues, basically. And 33% are functional issues, and around 10% are test catch-up issues, and 7 to 8% are test infrastructure issues. So we classify the issues on these basis, and we want to analyze how to detect automatically whatever issue that is popping up on a day-to-day basis, okay? So we came up with this architecture, log analytics. What we do is we typically parse the logs and search for the log level, basically. If you have an idea on how logging is done, there are basically multiple levels of logging: info, debug, warning, and error. So what we do is we parse the logs and we look for errors, the log entries of kind errors, and then we generate patterns out of it. We'll go deep into it on the further slides. So this is the architecture. The first segment is like the automation log segment where the agents will generate the logs, and those logs are read by file beats, and these are fed or ingested by Logstash, and then indexed with Elasticsearch. And visualization we are doing with Kibana, okay? Similarly, we do the same thing with application server logs as well. So ELK stack with FileBeat, those who are not aware of ELK stack, Elasticsearch is a free open source distributed RESTful search and analytics engine built on top of Apache Lucene. Basically, it's a full text search algorithm. Logstash is a server-side data processing pipeline that ingests data from multitude of sources simultaneously. Basically, you can feed Logstash with multiple sources. Not only one client, I can feed with n number of clients. In our case, we are providing an input stream for Elastic and for storage and search. Kibana, as I said, it lets you to visualize your Elasticsearch data, and it can be used as exploration tool for log and time series analytics and application monitoring and operational intelligence use cases. A FileBeat is a lightweight shipper for forwarding and centralizing log data, and it monitors the log files and locations that you specify. And it has various capabilities like generating charts, reports. It can generate geospatial charts also. And Elastic has a very good documentation. You can go through the link where you can download all these plugins for Elastic and you can install it. On a high level, we'll go through the configuration of each and every plugin which comes along with Elastic. So Elastic run the following command. Once you download, basically what you need to do is go to the command prompt and run the command which is shown there, bin Elasticsearch. It will automatically ups the server, Elastic server. And for configuration, we are using elasticsearch.yml file. And we have different options to name the particular cluster or node. Configuring Elasticsearch is a typical similar to Kibana or Elastic. So we have to execute that command, and logstash configuration file consists of three parts: input, filter, and output. I'll explain you all the three parts. So the configuration file consists of input, like from which port or the, how the logs are shipped from file B to logstash. Basically, we are reading the log input on the port 5048, which is the default port for file bit. And we have filter. Basically, we read each and every log entry from the logs, and we parse that. And for parsing, we have a grok expression, and we are doing it by time zone, time slicing approach. And grok pattern will parse the unstructured log data into something structured and queryable. And logs timestamps will be ingested into time zone specified. Basically, we have this feature where my server log is generating logs on UTC, but I want to convert that into IST or PST. We have this feature in logstash which can be converted. And finally, the output. The logstash output can be shipped or pointed towards Elastic, or I can point it directly towards the Kibana. So this is the grok expression I was talking about. If you see, there are roughly five parts to it. The first part is timestamp. You can see the section below, it is showing the timestamp, the first part, and then space, and then we are actually mapping a keyword to the next section. Here, the keyword is log level, and it is mapped to info, okay? And the next word is class name. Basically, what is my class name that is putting this log into logs, log entry into logs. And the next one is the line number in that particular class. And then we are actually reading the entire message into one keyword, greedy data. So Kibana, configuring Kibana, we should run this command. And the kibana.yml file is for the configuration. We can specify port. The default port is 5601. We can actually specify the host name if it is not the local host, and define similarly the server name, and Elastic search URL, basically where it gets the data from. So configuring file bit, so ELK can be configured at any folder or any drive, but file bit should be configured in C drive program files. So we host this file bit as a service so that at any time, any new log or new log entry is written to log, this will read and parse it and supply it to the logstash, Elastic, or Kibana. So first of all, to install that as a service, you have to execute the install service file bit ps1 command. And to start that, you have to execute the start service file bit command. Once you execute this command, it will be hosted as a service, and you can turn on it on and off using Task Manager as well. So this is the example for file bit. You can see the path where the logs are residing. Basically, you are mentioning the log file path from where it should read the logs, and the multi-line pattern. If you see our logs in server logs or in Selenium logs, whenever an error is encountered, we'll get an stack trace exceptions with multiple lines. So multi-line pattern describes or sets a rule saying that if my log line starts with a date or timestamp, it should consider that line as one starting point of the entry, log entry, and again, another timestamp is encountered, all the multi-line log entries will be considered as a single entry, so that you can read all the stack trace from the logs. And logging level, we are putting it as info. We want to not only read the errors and classify the errors, we want to generate different kinds of dashboards. Say, for example, how many instances of a class is executed, or how many instances of a particular method is executed on a day-to-day test execution. So we can generate such meaningful kind of dashboards and reports using file bit. So this is the output path, C program data file bit logs. Sorry, it is a centralized location where it will be storing and sending it to the Elastic. The last part is output.logstash, where it will be pushing. Here we can, as I said, file bit can be sending data to logstash, Elastic, and Kibana. In our case, we are sending it to logstash, and we are mentioning the IP address and port. So these are the charts which we have generated from Kibana. And you can see the charts, the number of errors that are encountered on a time slicing basis. We are parsing the logs and we are generating the patterns. And as we have seen in the grok expression, we're actually mapping each keyword to the log entry part. And we are basically generating the aggregations based on time sliced approach to get insights. As I said, how many hits are there for a particular class in this time, and how many errors are encountered for a particular tenant or a functionality that can be mapped. So how does this help? Basically, pattern matching using timestamp, logged in username, tenant, and different modules or functionality will give you the insights of like how many test cases are more concentrating on which part of the functionality, or how are the errors encountered in our application, which part of the application is more buggy, or which is which is functionally instable. We can build analytics for error pattern analysis and map these patterns to test execution failures. So what we are trying to do is, as I said, there are four different classification of errors. The first one is functional issues. So how we are doing it is, whenever an error is encountered at a server log or application log, in a similar time frame, say for example, in less than 2 minutes, we are encountering an error entry in Selenium logs. So we are matching these two errors by timestamp, logged in user, and tenant, and module or class name. If all these four keywords are matching, there is a 90 to 95% chance that that is a functional issue. And we can monitor and validate pattern matches for accuracy. Even though there is 90 to 95% of accuracy, there are few instances where we have encountered false positives. Say, for example, there would be an unwanted log entry in server log, and we have a test case which failed due to some other issue, not a functional issue. So when such cases are encountered, basically we analyze that and we mark them, or we blacklist them, basically. So that's how we eliminate the false positives. So this is the custom charts based on hits. Here, one hit means there is a log entry in application server log as well as Selenium log at the same time. So we consider that as a hit, and the probability of hit to be a functional bug is, as I said, 90 to 95%. So challenges and whatever challenges we have faced, and what are the mitigation strategies? Poor logging practices, like as I said, developers or QA people does not log properly. Say for example, they swallow the errors, and they won't log it, the exceptions. Logging errors as warnings or info. As I said, log level, even though I get an exception, if I catch the exception, I would enter that as a logger.info rather than logger.error. And unwanted log entries to make it difficult to segregate. There are unwanted log entries in server log as well as Selenium log, which are not required. So the mitigation strategies what we followed were blacklisting unwanted log entries and identifying the false positive errors in both server side as well as test automation side. This actually drastically improved our accuracy in finding functional issues, not only functional issues, but also other kind of issues like flaky test issues or test infrastructure issues. So what next? To improve accuracy of finding functional issues and other errors, We want to use XPAC. It's another plugin of Elastic, where it has machine learning capabilities, and it can improve the accuracy based on false positives. And we want to build an engine to identify functional and other issues automatically. So as I said, this concept is not limited to the Elastic stack or Selenium. It can be built upon any automation tool and any log mining tool. Say, for example, in market, we have many other tools which can be replaced with Elastic here. Say, for example, Sumo Logic is one tool, and Splunk is other tool, which can actually parse the logs, and it can generate dashboards and reports. Okay. Think we have a minute. Okay. So I just want to show. So this is the Logstash Kibana server, how we are doing it. So when I start file bit, it starts to ingest data into Logstash. So all the Elastic, Logstash, and Kibana are installed in my machine only. So I'm actually parsing the log which is there in my local machine into my machine only. We can have a distributed system catered around multiple machines to build the same thing. So we'll see how this data can be seen in Kibana. I'm creating an index. Something is not working. Something went wrong. So as I said, these are the custom dashboards we have. So if you see here, application log entry, there is an entry in the application log at 24th June, early morning, 2 o'clock. Similarly, we have entry at 2 minutes after the application server log. We can mark that as a functional issue. Basically, all the timestamps, tenant, username, and module are matching in this case. And this is other kind of report what we have developed. We can see the failures of a particular test case in last 1 week. How many times the same test case has failed, and what are the different reasons for that? That's it. We can move on to Q&A.
Yep. Thank you, Manoj. I believe lunch is starting shortly outside. But if you have any questions for Manoj, he's more than welcome to answer some of them. Any questions?
Hey, Manoj. Yeah. So far, good talk. So my question is, we haven't seen any group by test the failures. So you said like you are executing 3,000 tests parallelly, and what happened when, let's say, as you said, right, 300 tests are failing per day, and I need to debug 300 tests. I don't want to see each and every job in Jenkins and see what it could be a failure because might be login is broken, right? And I don't want to debug or 300 tests which failed because of just login, right? So you didn't show anything like because of login, all of the 300 tests are failed. So can you just explain where can I see those things?
Basically, we can see that So you can build your own custom report in Kibana, where I can actually drag and drop the filters or add filters, and then see the, say for example here, if you want to, filter on something, on message, you can do that. You can add a filter here. So you can see there is only one hit with the message. So you can actually classify or get the log entries or classification particular keywords, and then make a filter out of it and generate a dashboard. So it could be login or any other issues. Suppose a single functional issue might result in 500 test cases, failures. I can still search that error, and I can filter that or generate by generate a report on top of it.
All right, cool. Thank you, Manoj. Let's give him a round of applause. All right, and I think lunch is outside. So thank you. Hope you're enjoying the Selenium conference.